Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Wicked Angel, a novel by Taylor Caldwell. Narrated by Tanya Eby. The wicked ones, who are constantly being born amongst us, are often distinguished by appearing as angels of light and wit and intelligence, charming and fascinating beyond usual mortal endowments, apparently loving, and always exciting love, even among those who are of a usually cynical nature. In truth, they appear most lovable and amiable, for it is their diabolical genius to be all things to all men, grave among the grave, gay among the gay, sympathetic in the company of those of sensibility, never openly hostile or belligerent, flexible of temperament, of an open countenance, and invariably possessed of great magnetism. More of these wicked ones are born in each generation than we know of, but those who are unfortunately of their blood know that they entertain a demon, and not unawares. May God preserve you and me from encountering one such in marriage or among our children. Proust. Chapter 1. He could feel the rage suddenly flaring in him. He liked to feel rage, for it meant not only a quick warm flooding about his loins, a hot, watery flooding, but also an intense inner excitement that made him experience a voluptuous heightening of all sensation. The external flooding brought his mother, full of coos and murmurs and exclamations meant to be chiding, but which were really endearing, giving him new importance. Unless, of course, she was there, as she was today, she, the deeply knowing, the deeply hated. On the few occasions when he had been alone with her, and she had angered him and so induced him to let out the flood, there had been no cooings, no pretended scoldings, which were later compensated for with candies and cookies. There had been only a harsh smiting on his buttocks, disgusted huge eyes glaring at him, words of contempt, and then the pushing away into a solitary room. He had never forgotten or forgiven. He hated her. He would always hate her. He dared not let loose the flood today. He dared not experiment to see if Mum would protect him from another assault, another stare of repulsion, more words of contempt. He was very sensitive, as were all his kind. He understood, at 4 years, without words. No, he must hold back the flood which welled in him with his rage, his face wrinkled with emotion and hate and self-pity. He wailed very softly as he sat on the doorstep outside the kitchen door. The voices went on, the voice of Mum and the voice of the hated her, and he could understand very little. He glowered. A pretty beetle ran near his foot, and he crushed it and smiled. He rubbed the innocent slime into the concrete with his heel. A butterfly flew close to him, and he darted out his hand to destroy it. It was very lovely, but also wary. It blew away from him, and he shrilled indignantly and rubbed his buttocks on the step. The garden, in full hot summer, lay all about him, golden, rose, white, violet, red, blue, and the maple trees held their fretted green banners to the shining sky. The grass glittered in the sun, the birds bustled on it, and, chattering, rose into the trees or sat at a distance on the old gray stone wall. He looked at it all restlessly. He leaned over and tore up a clump of grass at the side of the concrete walk and amused himself by ripping apart each blade separately. He kicked the stuffed bear below him. He put his thumb into his mouth again and again whined and looked at the birds and hated them and hated the voices in the kitchen behind him. For now, he understood that they were no longer discussing him, and this was outrageous. For there was nothing in the world as valuable and as precious as himself. Nothing significant lived in the world besides him, and the world was made to serve him, to wait upon his smiles, to stand beside his bed, to put delicious morsels into his mouth, to amuse him, to cry and laugh over him, to clap hands delightedly at his exploits, to turn in his direction adoring faces and worn, worshiping simpers. Dimly, as he tore viciously at the grass, he was tearing viciously at her and destroying her, who dared not to bend with supple waist and knee before him and acknowledge him for the mighty creature he was. Kathy Saint, who preferred to be known as Catherine, delicately tasted the chicken broth she was preparing for her son. The fine skin between her eyes puckered, and she shook her head. "I'm afraid it is a wee bit too salty," she said to her sister Alice, whom she preferred to call Alicia. For Kathy Saint was precious, and had a sweet predatory face and what her sister Alice sometimes thought of as a dainty shark's smile. Kathy loved people. She was lyrical about people. "More and more and more people," she would sing to Alice and her husband, lifting her skirts and sailing about any room in which she happened to be. "How can anyone live without people?" And her eyes would shine with what she believed was innocent joy in life and her fellow men. Her love for people did not extend to the cleaning women she employed, who never remained with her for more than 1 or 2 days, or the maids she hired, who left within a week, bag and baggage, or the tradesmen with whom she dealt, or the gardeners her husband had coaxed to work for the family. Among these people, she had a reputation for greed, merciless exploitation, arrogance, what they designated slave driving. She was a pretty woman of 35. No one but Alice knew her age. Her husband, Mark Saint, believed her to be nearer his own age, which was 32. She would soon celebrate her 30th birthday, as she called it, and Alice was visiting her today to discover, in her forthright manner, what Kathy wanted for the occasion. Alice did not often come to this house, for a number of reasons, among them a reason so hurting and so full of anguish that she could scarcely endure it, and which no one guessed. For she was in love with Mark Saint, and had loved him from the moment she had met him 10 years ago, when she was only 8, and he was engrossed with Kathy. He had married Kathy a year later. He had just been graduated from his school of engineering, and he was 23, and Kathy was 26, according to her birth certificate, but only 21, according to her own statement. Her parents were alive then, and entered into the deception with her, for they wished her to marry Mark, who was not only in a profession, but had inherited considerable money from his parents who had died in an automobile accident when he was 15. Kathy's parents owned a small but fairly prosperous little hardware store in the city, and they were awed by the handsome Mark Saint. They adored their older daughter and had left her the bulk of their savings, $15,000, the guardianship of Alice, their house, and their shop. Alice inherited only $3,000. No one thought this unjust, except Alice, and Alice was a child who kept her own counsel and had a wise and cynical inner eye. Kathy was considered very charming and even lovely by those she had deceived into believing her the gentlest, sweetest, most innocent, and most loving of women, and these, strangely enough to Alice, were legion. She was of medium height and gave the impression of slenderness, for her breasts were small, her shoulders narrow and thin, her arms only barely plump, her waist nearly slim. But her belly and her buttocks and her legs were thick and heavy. The first two she restrained with elastic and steel, the latter she hid in buoyant skirts which swished in a very feminine fashion just below the curve of her gross calf. Because of the constant hurly-burly of her skirts, and this was pure art, none of her friends noticed the expanse of her peasant ankles nor the breadth of her large feet. It had been quite a shock to Mark to discover on his wedding night that his bride, after shedding the artful bouffant gown and petticoats, had the lower body and limbs of a very sturdy and lustful peasant, made for the plow and the field, the chum and the barn. It had taken him several shocked moments to force back his concentration upon Kathy's pale and luminous face, so daintily shaped, so sweet in expression, so lighted by large blue eyes, so exquisite of dimpled chin and small, pretty teeth between naturally red and smiling lips, her nose so finely shaped, her hair so purely auburn and curling. Even while concentrating on these charms, the thought occurred to him that he had never seen Kathy in a bathing suit before their marriage. The thought passed. He loved Kathy, who had such a tender, murmurous voice, such apparent innocence, such a rapturous, childish delight in all things, as she herself declared. In comparison, young Alice was nondescript, as everyone said who understood the meaning of the word. At 18, as she was now, she was much taller than Kathy, very much thinner, and possessed of the most graceful body and legs and long throat. But her hair was almost flaxen, and short and dense and straight about her colorless and oddly patrician face, which very few appreciated for its sculptured planes and look of cleanliness and wise purity. Her young mouth, barely touched with lipstick, had a somewhat stern expression, for no one could deceive Alice, though Kathy would sometimes refer to her with a tender laugh as a teenager. How the plebeians who had been her parents had produced such aristocracy, no one questioned, for there were only one or two who recognized native aristocracy when they saw it, and Mark was one of them. Where Kathy was feminine, as her affectionate friends declared, Alice was womanly, and Mark, after these 10 years, understood the difference. Kathy had but one rule in judging women. Was so-and-so feminine, or was she not? She was convinced that Alice, the poor dear child, is unfeminine, I'm afraid, perhaps even a little, just a wee little bit, masculine, unfortunate. Alice's face, her gestures, her exquisite movements, her grace, her honesty, the lift of her head, her sudden infrequent smile which glorified all her features and removed their delicate sternness, had no touch of masculinity. She was, in all things, in her thoughts, in her faith, in her wisdom, in her inner strength, in her compassion, even for Kathy, the most womanly of women. Kathy, in the secret places of her devious and envious heart, in the smallness of her spirit, in her lack of largeness of vision, knew all about her sister, and so subtly belittled her in order to enhance her own stature and blatant femininity. Alice envied no one, nor truly hated anyone, except one creature, and he sat outside now, on the kitchen doorstep. She did not reproach herself for hating a 4-year-old handsome and smiling child. That would have been hypocrisy and alien to her nature. She accepted her emotions simply and understood them fully without illusion. She did not yearn to have a house like this one, big and expensive, with steep slated roofs, warm brick walls covered with ivy, a spacious garden, several glittering bathrooms, and an extremely modern kitchen. She would have been glad to share a dusty room in an obscure rooming house with Mark Saint, and would have lain down beside him on a rickety bed with joy and contentment, her heart swelling with the deepest of passions and love, her arms held out to him to give him comfort and happiness. But no one knew this, not even the sly and astute Kathy, who preferred to call herself Catherine. She would have borne Mark's children as soon as possible, and not have thriftily waited for 4 years, until we can really afford to have one, you know, as Kathy said with her gentle, self-deprecating smile, which endeared her to so many of the undiscerning. Alice's inheritance from her parents, so small and so unjust, had been spent on her education and care, as Kathy said. But Alice had been educated in public schools, at no expense, and had been graduated at 15 from preparatory school, the highest in her class. She had then gone to teacher's college and had covered the course in a little less than 3 years, and now taught school in the city. Immediately upon her graduation, she had left this house, to Kathy's relief, but vocal reproach, and shared a 2-room apartment with another teacher. She did not like the suburbs, she insisted, and this was one of the very few lies she had ever uttered. And it was spoken to remove the hurt expression from Mark's dark and clever face and clear hazel eyes. But living so close to him was beginning to mean unbearable anguish for her. And even when she visited this house, she almost always came during the day and rarely encountered Mark except on special occasions. Moreover, her hatred for young Angelo, as Kathy had fancifully insisted on naming him to Mark's disgust and Alice's unspoken disdain, was becoming too huge for continued silence. When Kathy first saw her son, 2 hours after his birth, she had cried, "Angel," and then had sought a name that would permit her to so call him all the days of her life. It was fall summer now, and Alice was taking an extension course at the city's university in order to obtain her master's degree. She intended, later, to become a PhD, and then teach in the university or in another city's college. Marriage to anyone but Mark Saint was unthinkable to her 18-year-old and intellectual mind. The steadfastness of her love never diminished, never changed, was never diverted by any other man. The latest maid in the Saint household was, as Kathy pettishly put it, lazing away on our time. Though the girl was merely exercising her right to an hour's rest after a strenuous day of work under the complaining lash of Kathy's sharp tongue. Elsie's day began at 6 o'clock, when she had to rise from her bed in a small room on the 3rd floor to bring Angelo's fresh orange juice and vitamins, to examine whether he had committed a nuisance during the night, which he often did, spitefully, to annoy the constant stream of maids who came and then left in bitter anger, and then to give him his bath and coating of fragrant powder, upon which Kathy insisted. "I want to keep him a baby as long as possible," she would carol sweetly. "A child deserves the precious days of his babyhood and cuddling and pampering. They are so short." After this coddling, he must then have his cereal, eggs, and mixture of cream and milk. All this was not accomplished without great difficulty, for Angelo had a high temper and native brutality, and the child's instinctive cruelty and malice, which, in Angelo, were accentuated. He hated the maids. He understood that his mother exploited them and degraded them with her condescension and her general vicious treatment, and so, to him, they were mean and worthless creatures who deserved tormenting. He liked to see them pale with anger, or color with frustration when they served him, or weep despairingly when he was particularly malicious and detestable. They enhanced his sense of importance, his belief that he stood in the center of the world, and that all was made for his own purpose. "How is Elsie coming along?" asked Alice, standing near her sister, who was anxiously seasoning Angelo's special chicken broth. The fine kitchen was paneled in knotty pine, one wall covered with shining copper vessels of all sizes. Chintz curtains of blue and coral blew gently at the windows, and the blue kitchen furniture gleamed with a coating of plastic wax. Kathy shrugged. She wore a dotted dimity dress, the exact color of her eyes, and the furniture, with her usual fluffy skirts and stiff petticoats, which concealed the grossness of her belly and buttocks and thighs and upper calves. Her lovely auburn hair curled moistly about her pale and translucent face, and she looked charming, as usual. The kitchen was hot, in spite of the breeze at the windows. Kathy glanced at her sister with a moo of despair, then remembered that this was Alice, or Alicia, and that she need not act or pretend. So she frowned and said with some surliness, "Oh, she's not as bad as all the others. Does as little as possible. She's sulking upstairs now because I insisted that she wash out a batch of Angel's underwear and dear little shirts and pants and stockings. Only about an hour's work in the basement with our washer and dryer and ironer. But what can you expect of such trash?" Alice's stern young mouth, which often relaxed into intense softness in spite of herself, became tight. "Don't you have a laundress twice a week, Kathy?" "Oh, Alicia, how many times must I insist that you call me by my right name, Catherine? It's so vulgar to be called Kathy." "That's what you were baptized," said Alice bluntly. "Never mind. Go on." "Yes, I have the laundress." Kathy clattered a spoon on the sink with vexation. "But in this weather, really, I don't want Angel's clothing to get the least bit musty. And I do change him so often." The boy, outside, hearing his beloved name, lifted his head alertly and tried to follow the conversation. "But, Catherine, you know that you told Elsie, as you tell all the maids, that they never have to do any laundry or heavy cleaning. It isn't fair to demand that they do after you hire them. And Elsie is such a good cook and so competent and responsible. And you pay her so little. I often wonder how you get them, honestly." But Alice knew. A prospective maid was invariably fascinated by Kathy's air of innocent sweetness, her tender words, her look of melting trust, her promises, her trilling laughter, her affectionate demands that if Mary or Jane or Elsie took the position, she really must consider herself one of the family. Under the spell of sisterly democracy and the wealth of promises, the hint of not too burdensome work, the selected girl always accepted the position. She remained not more than a month, or perhaps only a week, to leave in indignation and disillusion, and sometimes in hatred. If she were foolish enough to give Kathy's name as reference to another employer, Kathy made it her duty to enlighten the woman about the maid's incompetence, insolence, and sloth, and would even hint of missing lingerie or linen or silver, and all this in such a sighing, suffering voice that the girl was never hired. No one knew of this but Alice, who usually warned the girl quietly not to give her sister's name as a reference. She herself would write out an appreciative note and slip a bill into the envelope. The boy outside scowled and kicked his stuffed bear, for he did not hear his name. When Alice spoke, he put his hands over his ears and felt again that spiteful urge to soil himself, and then remembered, again, the one or two occasions when Alice, who watched him between maids when Kathy and Mark were away at dinner, had thrashed him for his incontinence. She was talking again, and he writhed a little on the step. "Do try and keep Elsie," said Alice, while Kathy covered the soup pan with the hushed care of one handling a holy thing. "She's very good." "Let's change the subject," said Kathy in her natural voice, which was hard and flat. "You asked me what I wanted for my birthday. You have only your salary, and you're spending your first year's savings at the university, and heavens know why. Well, I'd like an automatic fryer." "That's about $35, said Alice, in an expressionless tone. "Yes, very cheap, isn't it?" Alice thought of the small sum remaining in the bank. This was only the middle of August. She would not receive her first paycheck for over a month. "Of course," she thought, "I can always charge it and pay for it in October." "An automatic fryer, then, it is," she said, her eyes a blue much darker than Kathy's and filled with the radiance of intellect, clouded a little. She detested being reminded of her sister's native avarice. Kathy gave her a peeping glance. "You really should get married, dear," she said. "You'll soon be 19, and it's time for you to be looking around for someone substantial and responsible, like Mark. You'll never realize the joy of marriage until you have a child like Angel." "I thought the joy of marriage was in the husband," said Alice dryly. "Don't quibble. Mark's a darling, of course, but marriage means children." "Why don't you have another, then?" asked Alice. She was distressed to hear a faint taunting note in her own voice, but she was thinking of Mark, who existed, in Kathy's mind, as the father of her child and the provider of his comforts and the means of creating a large inheritance for him. "Oh, how can you say that, Alicia?" cried Kathy in a despairing voice. "I had such a hard time when Angel was born." "And besides," said Alice, and wondered at herself, 35 is a little old to be having more children, isn't it?" There was a sudden silence in the hot, bright kitchen. Kathy's face took on a shade of venom, and her eyes sparkled. Then Elsie, her features set sullenly, entered the room, and Kathy said with sharpness, "It's 4:05. You were supposed to be down here 5 minutes ago." "I'm tired, Mrs. Saint," said Elsie. Her tone was ominous, and Alice knew immediately that good Elsie was preparing to leave in a short time. But Kathy never knew or cared. There were countless Elsies just waiting to be exploited, if only for a few weeks, at a small salary, and most easy to deceive with a beguiling smile and honeyed lies. "How are you, Elsie?" asked Alice, going to the girl who was beginning to wash some dishes. Elsie looked over her shoulder at the younger girl and smiled. Now, she thought, Miss Knowles was a really lovely person. You never knew how lovely she was until you'd seen her a few times. Elsie regretted that she would not see Alice again. "Fine, Miss Knowles," said Elsie. "Do hurry with those dishes," said Kathy. "It's almost time for Angel's little snack." The boy heard his name once more, and he smiled in beatitude. He stood up, reached high for the knob of the screen door, and entered the kitchen, stamping his feet loudly. His smile disappeared. He began to whine fretfully and gave Alice a malevolent look. Alice returned this with a regretful smile. It was dreadful to hate the child. Was it Kathy's fault? Alice silently shook her head. She hoped it was so, and often she prayed that Angelo would improve as children had a habit of improving when the world assaulted them with reality and refused to coddle them as their mothers coddled them, and demanded of them some semblance of humanity and decent behavior, or be rigorously punished. When Kathy saw her son, her face radiated pure light. She swept him up into her arms with a cry of ecstasy, almost lascivious in its undertone. She pressed him to her breast and covered him with kisses. She knew the exact posture to take, legs a little apart, supple waist bent backwards, one shoulder raised a trifle, one arm about the boy just so. The other arm lifted and the hand curled and caressing, to create a charming picture of mother and child. As usual, Alice thought to herself, and again with regret, that Kathy was a very amateur ham. She wondered if Kathy assumed this posture without an audience. It was very possible. Alice regarded Angelo gravely, as his mother kissed and fondled him, and he grinned at her with knowing malice, for he was a very intelligent child with every child's acute awareness of the emotions of adults. He was much larger than the average child his age. and muscular rather than fat, and he was quite the handsomest boy Alice had ever seen. She taught young children a year or so older than her nephew, and some were handsome and some were pretty. None could compare with Angelo. He had been born handsome, with no redness, no withered skin, no distortions, no simian resemblances. At birth, his hair was as crisply curled and dark red as it was now, his light brown eyes as big and shining, his skin as smooth and fair, his lips as pink, his cheeks as dimpled, his nose as well-shaped, his chin as round and firm, his ears as excellently formed. He had had none of the unfocused stare of the usual baby. Almost from birth, he seemed acutely knowing. He resembled his parents. He had Kathy's overt charm, her fascinating smile, her coaxing ways, when it pleased him to coax rather than demand with screams of rage. His profile sometimes reminded Alice achingly of his father, and so her hatred was not always steadfast. "My precious one," Kathy sang, and began to whirl about the kitchen with the big boy in her arms, her skirts lifting and swaying, her bright auburn hair flying about her face. "My darling, mother's adorable, mama's delight, ooh, ooh, ooh." Angelo's gaze never left Alice's averted face, and he chuckled, and when he pinched his mother's cheek, his touch was less savage and deliberately hurting than usual. Kathy kissed the strong, tanned fingers and threw back her head to let her worshiping eyes look upon her child. "Oh, Alicia," she sang lyrically, "this is what I mean about marriage." She let Angelo slide to the floor, following his passage with kisses on random spots. "Oh, Alicia, don't you miss him, now you've left him?" Alice said. "I wish you'd call me by my right name, Kathy." She looked about for her purse, and then remembered she had left it in the hall. "I really must go. I have at least 4 hours study waiting for me," Kathy said, in her hard change of tone, to Elsie, who was regarding Angelo with a curious expression. "Take Angel to the powder room. It's been 2 hours."
"No,"
shouted Angelo, stamping his foot. "I don't want to go." "Oh, darling, you must. You must. You know how you love the pretty green potty in the powder room. But would you rather go upstairs?" She half squatted before him, with her head cocked like an adoring dog, her eyes intent and anxious.
"No, no,"
he shouted, and beat his strong feet on the coral linoleum tiles. "I want the green potty." "Can't she keep her hands off him a minute?" thought Alice, disgusted. "She mauls him all the time." Kathy squealed with joy at her son's decision and clapped her hands. She lifted him in her arms again. "I'll take you," she said in that singing voice, and left the kitchen with Angelo and entered the large, cool hall, whose floor was covered with black and white glimmering marble. Alice could hear the quick pattering of her footsteps on the stone and her constant murmurous words of endearment. Alone with Elsie, she said in a low voice, "Elsie, this job isn't too bad. Why don't you stay?" Elsie answered at once and simply, "You know I'm going, Miss Knowles. Then you must know I just can't stay. I'm sorry, but it's that kid. He kicked me twice today, and I've got bruises on my shins, and I can get much more somewhere else and more time off. Mrs. Saint said I could have practically every evening off, except when they went out, and it isn't so. I have to sit up there with that kid and watch him breathe and sing to him until he's asleep, except the times Mrs. Saint wants to sing him to sleep or read to him. Even then, I've got to be around to do anything he wants if he wakes up. And they have a lot of company, Mrs. Knowles. Last week, there was only one night when they didn't, and I didn't get through until 12 o'clock, and I have to be up at 6. I wouldn't have taken the job if I'd known," she added with bitterness. "Too much work. I've got to go every second. If I sit down, Mrs. Saint finds something for me to do." "I'm sorry. She's your sister, and I guess I shouldn't be talking this way." She regarded Alice, troubled. She was a strong, short girl, clean-looking and with an air of self-respect, and her brown hair was neatly combed, and her brown eyes were firm and without guile. Alice sighed and looked at the floor between her feet. Elsie was the best maid Kathy had had to date, a deft and knowing cook, a good worker, and possessed of dignity and pride. "All right," said Alice. "Of course, you must do what's best for yourself. I understand." She hesitated. "If you want me to, Elsie, I'll write the reference for you." The two girls regarded each other straightly and with comprehension. Elsie nodded, and her mouth quivered for a moment.
I haven't told Mrs. Saint yet. I'm going to give her a week's notice tonight. But honest, Miss Knowles, I don't know how I'm going to stand another week. I do like Mr. Saint. He's a real nice man and considerate, and he always talks to me like I'm a human being, and Mrs. Saint don't. And I thought she was so wonderful when I took the job 3 weeks ago. That's the kind of a fool I was. I'm sorry, I shouldn't.
Alice looked about the immaculate kitchen. Every room in the house was immaculate and shining, polished and gleaming. Kathy received her money's worth from her maids and her cleaning women, and she was tireless herself and had a remarkable sense for line and color and decoration. She was the admiration and terror of interior decorators. Everything was of the best quality, unique and distinctive. Like Kathy herself, the house was charming. Her words might be banal, her intellect not too dazzling, but her taste was flawless. Alice sometimes thought of her sturdy parents, who preferred red velvet draperies and mohair, heavy furniture, and brown thick carpets, and she wondered where Kathy had acquired her flair for the fine, the noble, the appropriate. The girl smoothed her gray linen dress with her hands and pondered. She herself, as she readily admitted, had no such flair as Kathy's. The older woman returned to the kitchen, laughing and showing all her small white teeth in delight.
He's growing up, my little baby. He won't let me stay with him anymore when he's on the potty. My big, big boy.
He certainly is, said Alice wryly. I'm glad you've remembered that. He'll be in kindergarten in less than a year, or perhaps in first grade, if he ever learns to control himself. Kathy's face changed.
Alicia, you don't know anything about children, and that's bad for the children. I have a new book on child psychology. I wish you'd read it. All psychiatrists are unanimous in saying that children get tremendous pleasure from soiling themselves, even when they're older than Angel. And parents shouldn't deprive them of that pleasure too soon. You can ruin a child's life, inflict a trauma on his emotional nature, if you force toilet training on him too soon. Ask any psychiatrist.
No, said Alice. I prefer to ask people who have common sense. Angelo's past 4. If he were my child, I'd whack him until he stung for hours, and he'd remember after that. Kathy shrugged and smiled. I pity the children in your class.
I can tell you one thing, said Alice. They don't come equipped with diapers. Not even children almost as young as Angelo. No teacher would stand for it a minute, and the other kids would teach him a sound lesson the very first time.
No wonder so many poor children are suffering mental blocks and have emotional difficulties, said Kathy, with a sentimental sigh, and have to suppress hostile feelings and have conflicts, and no wonder we have so many juvenile delinquents.
Kathy, don't be such a fool, repeating that psychiatric jargon all the time. You know hardly any more about children than the psychiatrists do. You were Mark's stenographer, remember? And a good one. And you're a fine housekeeper and the world's best cook. Stay within your limits. Now, don't glare at me. I've really got to go.
Oh, but I want you to see my new bedroom draperies, cried Kathy, waving away her sister's words as puerile.
Wonderful material, and you couldn't guess what it cost me to have them made up. I'm almost ashamed to tell you.
I'm sure you got the advantage of Mrs. Sears, said Alice, with no expression on her face. You always do. She doesn't make a cent doing your work. What do? Hypnotize her or something? Or do you give her lessons in child psychiatry free? She supports 2 grandchildren, doesn't she?
She gets her biggest benefit from the reputation she has of working for the Saints, snapped Kathy. And don't think she doesn't brag about it.
But there was no color of embarrassment on her cheeks.
And what harm is there in driving a good bargain and getting your money's worth? Or a little more?
I'll see the draperies another time, said Alice, turning away. Besides, isn't it getting late for Angelo's precious little snack? He's been on the pot for some time now.
Kathy rushed to the refrigerator to bring out the daintily decorated cottage cheese mold, the gelatin, pink and shining, and the glass of milk in the gay little jug for her son. While she was busy laying them out on the kitchen table, Alice smiled at Elsie and went into the large hall, where it was so pleasantly cool, the marble so perfectly polished, the great curving stairway floating up to the 2nd floor. The girl paused a moment to enjoy what she had most willingly left, but still regretted. The walls, of painted ivory, bore a few excellent modern originals in bright and vivid colors, framed exquisitely. At another wall stood a Chippendale mirror mounted over a beautiful console. It was on this console that Alice had laid her purse. It was not there now.
"Do wait a minute," called Kathy from the kitchen. "I want to tell you something." "Alicia?"
"All right," said Alice. She was certain she had left her purse there. Her books still remained on the console. She had put her purse upon them. She glanced at the authentic Chippendale chair near the staircase, but her purse was not to be seen. She frowned. Something caught her eye near the grilled glass door leading outside. The powder room door to the right was slightly open. She went to it at once, saying, "Angelo, have you taken my purse?" She knocked on the door and it swung inward at her touch. The pretty room was empty. Angelo was not there, but on the black tiled floor lay Alicia's purse. She looked at it with incredulous shock. It had been opened, and all its contents were scattered on the floor, and all had been methodically ruined. The lipstick had been wrenched from its gilt holder, the holder flattened, the lipstick ground into the tiles. The silver compact, which Mark had given Alice for Christmas, was open, the glass broken, the powder poured out. Its curved lid had been battered by a strong heel and wrecked. The sunglasses had been smashed against the basin, and the plastic twisted and left in a full 2 inches of water. The little jeweled comb, of which Alice was so proud, floated in the toilet. Her wallet had been opened, the bills thrown about, some in the bowl. One or two had been torn into shreds. Her change purse yawned open. A litter of silver and copper lay on the floor. Her lace handkerchief had been befouled. Her tiny perfume holder lay splintered in fragments in a corner, and the room smelled strongly of the precious and hoarded French scent. Aghast and now trembling, Alice sat down on her heels and looked upon the bestial vandalism her nephew had committed against her. What she saw was his rage that she knew all about him. She saw his hatred of her perspicacity and of herself. This was not simply childish malice done unthinkingly. It was a horrifying display of something too evil to be thought of a malignance too unchildlike. Alice shuddered. She did not hear the hall door open, and she fell forward on her knees as a masculine voice called to her heartily, "Alice, what are you doing there? Saying your prayers?" She was too sick to reply for a moment. There was a huge salt lump in her throat, and a dimness before her eyes. A shiver of desperate coldness ran over her flesh. Then, still kneeling, she put out her hands to cover, to hide, from Mark Saint, what she did not in mercy wish him to see. She said in a shaking voice, not looking at him, "Oh, it's too stupid. I dropped my purse and look what happened."
"What a mess," he said sympathetically, in his kind, strong voice, which she loved so deeply.
He knelt down beside her.
"Let me help you."
He tossed his briefcase aside. Then he whistled. He picked up the compact and examined it. His face changed, darkened, and Alice said quickly, "When it all fell out, I stepped on the poor compact." His shoulder was against hers, his dark flannel shoulder, and she wanted to burst into tears. She scrabbled blindly at the ruin of her possessions and tried to laugh. The sound was almost a moan.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.